May the sound of the bell remind us that the Spirit of God is within us and among us.
We gathered here for worship. The life and spirituality of the Atikamekw Anishinaabe people preceded us. We worship here on their traditional territory with deep gratitude, and we pledge to seek to walk in faithfulness and reconciliation. We begin our worship service this morning with an important announcement by Amy Holman Grout about Spirit Quest.
Thank you. So families, are you and your kids tired of experiencing life through a screen? Well, we have the antidote starting next week with Wild Spirit Quest. We have been meeting for 2 years on Zoom, if you can believe it. And now is our chance to gather in person, and it will be outside. We'll be meeting every week, and the structure of the session will be based on a typical Church of the Wild service. So we'll have an altar outside, we'll have a candle, a moment of silence, then we'll have a reading, and we'll send the kids out with a specific goal into nature, and with the idea of them having a conversation with nature, a conversation with God through nature. We're really hoping that this will deepen their connection with the natural world and with God. And it's an experiment that we're trying until the end of the Spirit Quest year this year, and we'll reassess at that point. We're starting with Saturdays, but we're also going to try Sundays a little later in the spring, just to see which fits better for families. So every week will be a different location, a different wild location, and with different themes and the odd special guest. So next week, we are starting at Science North at 3 p.m., and we're going to be on the hill, on the grassy hill where all the geese usually gather. plenty of parking there, and we'll have a canopy in case things are rainy or snowy. Things to bring are water, good footwear, extra socks or mitts if you need them. And definitely, yeah, masks. We would like you to be masked while we're doing this, because we might be a little close at times. And we're going to make a video of each session, a little snippets of little experiences to show during the service next week, so we can all be knowing what we're doing, and so the kids that don't want to come can watch it at home or in person. And if you would like to help as a leader, we'd love to have you as a special guest. That would be wonderful, so let us know. And we're just very excited about this new venture, and we'll hope you'll join us. Thank you.
That sounds like so much fun, Amy. Thank you so much for sharing about that. I might come as a special guest just so I get to come. Friends, let's prepare our hearts and minds to worship God. We believe in a debonair God who clothes the wildflowers, dressing them so superbly that they outdo Solomon in all his glory, who is the true friend of all creatures, great and small, who feeds the blue jays and the chickadees, the chipmunks and raccoons. We believe in the God of Jesus Christ, the source of abundance full of grace and truth. We believe in the extravagant God who turns the other cheek, who goes the second mile, who turns water into the best wine, brings healing with every touch, and who welcomes a woman's act of love as she fills the house with exquisite fragrance. We believe in the redeeming God, who spared no cost, forgave even his crucifiers, had time for a dying thief at his side, and who on the third day did a thing so prodigious that even his friends were dismayed with joy. We believe in the God of Jesus Christ, the source of abundance wherever we turn and no matter what we do. So come, let us worship God. I'm going to call up Linda Ambrose to help with our Lenten candle lighting.
Good morning. Jesus has taught us that we must forgive, but at times we find this hard to do. We have been hurt, and we have hurt others. We have refused grace and carried grudges. We have allowed others to be poisoned by our own anger and resentment, and have denied the Christ-likeness in us.
Let us light a candle as a symbol of our faith in Christ, to help us forgive as we are forgiven, to help us to love as we are loved.
Please join with me in prayer. Faithful God, forgive us our shortcomings and help us to forgive others. As we journey towards the cross this Lenten season, help us to let go of our grudges and to forgive, and to seek forgiveness where we have gone wrong. Amen. Our first hymn is number 220 in Voices United.
Thank you.
In the midst of our sorrows and guilt, our doubts and regrets, we are bathed in the light and beauty that come from God. Trusting God's love for us, let us ask for God's grace. Let's pray. Because we have preserved our joy in manna jars for the long winter of despair, storing them in the dark corners of our souls, we have forgotten its gritty taste. Because we have put a tight lid on our delight and put it in the back of the pantry, we have forgotten how it can tickle our noses. Because we are so busy prattling pious platitudes about the poor, the least, the lost, we ignore your words which anoint them as your children. Because we have put up the shutters and storm doors to keep your future from sneaking in, we have missed the sweet breeze carrying your hope to us. Because we are who we are, restore us, Holy Grace, and make of us a fragrant offering to the world. Amen. Friends, sisters, brothers, let us hear this good news. By God's grace, we are free to live in the light of love. Thanks be to God. Amen. We're very fortunate to have Deb Knight with us, who's going to share a Spirit Quest Corner. Let's all listen carefully to what Deb has to share.
Good morning. We're still carrying on with the story of Jesus' days before he knew that he would die. So we're reading today from John 12, verses 1 to 8, and this is the story that continues. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to the home of Lazarus in Bethany. Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead. Excuse me. Martha served the dinner, Lazarus sat with Jesus at the table, and Mary, she took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard and anointed Jesus' feet. And then she wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance from the perfume. Judas Iscariot was one of his disciples. He was the one about to betray Jesus. He was there too, and he said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." So this story reminds me of advice someone very special taught me when I have a hard decision to make and I am uncertain what to do. My friend said to ask, "Where is the need?" I'm wondering if Mary was wise and asked this question to herself before she bought the very expensive perfume of nard. Where is the need? Perhaps Mary needed to tell Jesus she knew he was going to die. Sometimes it's difficult to find the words when you know someone you love is dying. Mary was very brave to face the fact that her beloved friend would die. Perhaps Martha, Lazarus, and Mary wanted Jesus to feel their love and friendship, so they had him for supper in the safety of their home. They knew this was troublesome for Jesus, a hard time. Sometimes when I know there's a family feeling sad because someone is very sick, dying, or they've died, I send some comforting food to their house. Charles, here from St. Peter's, often delivers food that has been made with love from the people of St. Peter's. I'm betting Charles also asks the question, where is the need? Perhaps because Jesus had raised Mary and Martha's brother Lazarus from the dead, Mary needed to express her gratitude. Maybe the gift of Lazarus having his life back was priceless to Mary. She could never really pay Jesus back for that, but she could buy the very expensive perfumed oil so she could tell Jesus by her actions that she was very grateful. Perhaps Mary needed Jesus to know how much she cared for him now and that she would care for him after he died. And even though she was sad, this was something she could do that was very special and would honor him. If only Judas Iscariot had asked, "Where's the need?" he might not have been so critical and judgmental of Mary. But he was a thief, and so he wasn't the kind of person to think about the needs of others. But Jesus, he understood. He very likely knew that Mary had asked herself, "Where is the need?" And Jesus understood. When he died, Mary would likely ask that question again when she cared for the poor. Here's a little prayer that was at the end of our spirit quest to say, "Dear God, who in the person of Jesus died just as we die and was raised to life again, help us to honor your death and life during this season of Lent. Be near us when we experience loss and endings. Amen."
Thank you so much, Deb. That was a wonderful interpretation. I love that wisdom. Thank you for sharing that with us. Isn't that the wonderful thing about Scripture, that there are many different ways to interpret the same reading? And so here's my interpretation of this morning's very famous Scripture passage from the Gospel of John. Let's pray. Loving God, in the speaking of these words, may your word be spoken, and in the hearing of these words, may your word be heard. Amen. It was a wedding almost 2 decades in the making. As to why they waited that long, 18 years to tie the knot, neither one could say for sure. Somehow the timing had never been right. Other things had taken priority. Life had gotten in the way, as life so often seems to do. But then, at long last, at the oddest of times and under the unlikeliest of circumstances, the stars had aligned and all the pieces fallen into place. And so there they were. The bride was radiant, her filmy white veil blowing gently in the breeze behind her as she made her way solemnly to the makeshift altar. The groom struggled unsuccessfully to choke back tears of joy. A couple of dozen guests looked on misty-eyed as the couple knelt before the priest and exchanged their vows. From this day forward, for better or for worse, till death do us part. In a lot of ways, it was nothing special. I mean, it wasn't any more special than any of the other 115,000 weddings that happen in the world every day. Under any other circumstance, it certainly wouldn't have made international news or any kind of news at all. But that's just it. That's what made this wedding anything but just one more. The circumstances, I mean. The venue wasn't a church or a banquet hall, but a military checkpoint on the outskirts of a besieged city. The aisle was formed not by tidy rows of cushioned chairs, but by jeeps and rocket launchers. The guests were not a joyful throng of family and friends, but a couple dozen beleaguered strangers, the preacher, a military chaplain, hastily summoned to preside over the impromptu formalities. The happy couple was decked out not in tux and gown, but in government-issue camo fatigues marked with the characteristic yellow band of the Ukrainian army. 6 months ago, heck, even 6 weeks ago, if someone had told Lesya Evichenko and Valery Filimonov that this was how their long put off wedding day was going to unfold, they probably would have reacted in much the same way anyone would. Like that was the stark, raving, craziest thing they'd ever heard. But then again, if you'd told Lesya and Valery and most of the rest of the population of war-torn Ukraine that literally overnight, their country would become a battlefield, that suddenly and without warning, their whole world would be thrown into complete and utter chaos, it likely would have evoked a similar reaction. But of course, that is exactly what has happened. The stark, raving crazy has come to pass. Almost unfathomably, in a little over a month, with the rest of the world watching on in horror from the sidelines, what was a beautiful, thriving, peace-loving nation has been reduced to a smoking, stinking, bombed-out hell on earth. And those ordinary people, people like Lesya and Valery, hairdressers and school teachers, doctors and lawyers, bus drivers and bank clerks, have been turned into ill-equipped, hastily trained civilian soldiers. Prior to that fateful day, February 24th, when the first Russian tanks rolled across the border, most Ukrainians were living the kind of lives people live, concerning themselves with the kind of things people concern themselves with when there isn't anything terribly consequential going on. First world problems, we call them. Misbehaving children and unreasonable bosses, tax hikes and traffic woes. The preoccupations of the privileged, those of us who are lucky enough to live much of the time under the illusion that life, in all its more or less uneventful day-to-dayness, will simply go on more or less uneventfully forever. Until suddenly, one day, for Lesya and Valery and 44 million other ordinary people, it didn't. Until that dreaded out of sight, out of mind forever came roaring in like a hurricane, leaving a wake of death and destruction behind us. Which brings us back to the peculiar wedding scene. When asked what inspired their decision to get married, when and where they did, Valery was quick to answer. "This war has taught us that you never know what's going to happen," he said. As Lesya reflects, "We must take as much as we can from every moment of life. I don't know what will happen tomorrow. I'm happy that I'm alive right now, that my husband is alive and he's with me. Right now, this is all we have, this one moment of happiness." This morning's gospel lesson from John, which Deb read for us as part of her Spirit Quest moment, finds Jesus and his disciples taking a rare, and one would imagine much needed, retreat. Their vacation destination is Bethany, a small village about a mile and a half west of Jerusalem, a place that Jesus had frequented so often it had become like a second hometown. His favorite haunt was the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, three siblings who had become like family to him. He loved them, and they loved him, like a brother from another mother. They referred to him as Lord, so it seems like they knew who he was. Still, they weren't disciples exactly, not in any formal sense, not like Peter and Andrew and that gang. They were more like confidants, kindred spirits amongst a scant handful of people in his life with whom he could be most fully himself, a man and a Messiah, one whose days were increasingly numbered. By this point, he was a wanted man. The comfortable, uneventful day-to-dayness of his earthly life, if his life had ever been like that, was soon to come to a grinding halt. forever was creeping up quickly, and he knew it. Just before we pick up the story this morning, the temple authorities had held an emergency council meeting to talk about the Jesus problem. The problem being his skyrocketing popularity amongst the people and the implications of that popularity for the powers that be holding on to their power. In the 3 years since he'd first burst onto the scene, he'd gone from being a manageable nuisance to a serious threat in the eyes of the Sanhedrin, the religious ruling council. The fact of the matter was becoming clearer by the moment. If they didn't shut him down, the Romans would, and all of Judea would suffer the consequences. It didn't take them very long to decide what to do. It simply had to be done. It wasn't enough to muzzle him, run him out of town, or throw him into prison. For the sake of the nation, in the interest of homeland security, Jesus had to die, just as soon as it could be arranged. So like I said, the clock was running out quickly, and he knew it. Whether or not Mary, Martha, and Lazarus had any idea about all of this, the story doesn't say. Nonetheless, Jesus must have seen it as a welcome distraction. To be taken in, cooked for, cleaned up, catered to have the world shut out, if only for a while. So picture the scene. Supper's on the table, and they all sit down to eat, passing pleasantries, catching up on the latest news, reminiscing about old times, doing what people do over dinner, in other words. Preoccupied as they are, and probably a little drunk by this point, no one even notices when Mary gets up and quietly leaves the room, until she comes back and proceeds to throw what, up to this point, had been a perfectly ordinary dinner into total chaos. Eyes downcast, without a word, she kneels at Jesus' feet and breaks the neck on the alabaster jar she's holding in her hands. Then, with every set of eyes in the room set squarely on her, she goes on to do four completely unexpected, absolutely scandalous things. First, she takes off her headscarf and lets her long black hair fall free, something which social convention of the time would have strictly forbidden an honorable woman to do, especially in a room full mostly of men. Then she tips the jar on end and pours the entirety of its contents onto Jesus' feet. The contents being a pound, that's right, I said a pound, of perfume. Not the discount drugstore kind, but the rarest, most exquisite, most expensive perfume that money could buy. And indeed, one would have had to have had money to buy it. The price tag was something in the order of 300 denarii, the rough equivalent of a year's wages for a laborer at the time, something in the order of $25,000. And she poured it on his feet. Not over his head, which would have been shocking enough, but on his dirty, calloused, sunburnt, ugly feet. And lastly, as a kind of grand finale, she proceeds to rub her hair all over those feet. That hanging loose hair that you'll recall ought to have been properly tied back and covered up. So imagine the onlooker's reaction. Wide eyes, dropped jaws, gasps of horror. It must have been a bit like when you pass a car wreck on the highway. You don't want to look, but you just can't help yourself. We can probably guess what sorts of thoughts were running through their minds as well. Outrageous. Disgraceful. What's gotten into her? Is she drunk? Is she crazy? But it wasn't just the brazen inappropriateness of her doing what she did that had them all fit to be tied. It was the waste. In the heat of the moment, it was Judas, who spoke up, but he only said what everyone else was thinking. Surely, Surely, with all the endless problems needing solving in the world, there were better, more important, more impactful, more responsible uses for $25,000 worth of perfume than a 5-minute foot massage. Why? That's the big question, right? Why did Mary do what she did? Why this embarrassingly lavish display, this peculiar passion play put on in the middle of supper? Anyone would say it was way over the top. So just what was her inspiration, her motivation? Down through the centuries, scholars have floated any number of theories. Maybe she was playing the prophet. Recognizing Jesus as a king, her anointing him was a way of revealing his royalty. Or maybe it was kind of a peremptory act of mourning. Intuiting that his life was coming to an end, she was getting a head start on preparing his body for burial. In the end, it's hard to know what was on Mary's heart and mind as she poured out her treasure on the feet of her friend and Lord. But I wonder whether the whole thing wasn't a whole lot simpler than the scholars' theories would make it out to be. What if, rather than some sort of pre-planned, well-staged ceremony, Mary's strange, many might say bad behavior, were simply a beautifully spontaneous, unrehearsed, spirit-led act of carpe diem, seizing the day? Even if she hadn't been gifted with the prophetic foresight, it wasn't hard to tell where his defiance of authority was going to land him, and if the rumor mill were to be believed sooner than later. His words only confirmed what her heart already knew. She wouldn't always have him. All the problems needing solving and in the injustices needing righting and the wars needing winning, sadly, until the kingdom came, they would always be there. There was plenty of time to be about the hard slogging work he'd given them to do. But the fact of the matter was, though she didn't know where or when or how it would happen, Mary was wise enough to know that her Jesus wouldn't always be sitting there, right in front of her, in the flesh, in her living room. She was wise enough to know that whatever might happen tomorrow, this moment of grace, unseized, would not come again. This blink and it's gone opportunity to take a pause and take a breath and simply revel in the beauty and wonder and goodness of life would all too quickly be swallowed up by the ever-looming storm of whatever was coming. And so wisely, some might say prophetically, Mary seized the moment. She took her chance. She did something big, something extravagant, something crazy, something defiant. Dropping her guard, laying bare her heart, impulsively, uncalculatingly, she dared, in a gesture more powerful than words could ever express, to give, to love, to live in the moment. The Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes famously says, "For everything there is a season and a right time for everything on earth. There's a right time for birth and another for death. A right time to kill and another to heal. A right time to destroy and another to build. A right time to hold on to what we have and another to give it away with wild abandon." Friends, in the life of discipleship, there is indeed a time to take Judas's words, if not his intentions, to heart. A time to be sober, a time to be solemn, a time for cross-carrying and weight of the world bearing. And it would seem, Jesus would say, I think, that there's a time in the same life of discipleship for taking a pause and taking a breath and reveling in the goodness of life. Though our hard-working, wrong-writing, United Church-style faith would rail against the notion, there is a time to back burner all our trying so hard to save the world and simply to seize this moment of happiness, like a wedding in a war zone. A time to set aside the petitions and put down the placards, to turn off the news and tune out the world, and simply pour out something rare and lovely and decadent at God's feet. Even for us, friends, there is a time, a once-in-a-while, fast-fleeting time, simply to be and to bask in the grace of the God who, even in the unlikeliest of circumstances, never fails to pour out God's love for us. And so we return to where we began. Same war zone, different scene. Outside a train station in the bombed-out city of Lviv, a young woman, dressed in a nylon winter jacket and knitted toque, sits at a slightly beat-up, upright wooden piano. Her stillness is a strange contrast to the unrelenting chaos all around her. Throngs of worried-looking people carrying bags and boxes and backpacks, milling about waiting for the train that will take them to safety, or so they hope. One wonders about her life, this young woman. What was it like before that fateful February day when the Russian tanks rolled in? Where did she live? What did she do? What were her hopes, her dreams, her aspirations? Who does she love, and where are they now? Is she too waiting for a train, forced to flee? And if she does, will she ever come back? Will she ever come home? How long has it been since she last had a decent meal, talked to her mother, slept through the night? Without looking up, she sets her fingers on the keys and starts to play. Her technique is excellent. She is clearly accomplished. And what does she play? What song does she choose for such a time and place as this? What piece most appropriate to the hellish circumstances in which she finds herself? It isn't a dirge or a requiem, not something in a minor key played ploddingly. A simple song, some might say inappropriately optimistic in tone, and she plays it with defiant gusto. A handful of people stop and listen, intrigued by the pop-up concert. One man pulls out a cell phone and starts recording, his bemused expression giving way to a weary smile as he recognizes the song, and perhaps the irony. For though no one is singing, he knows the words. I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, yes, even despite it all, what a wonderful world. Friends, we have been given so much. God has poured out an abundance of extravagance on our lives and given us the opportunity to share that extravagance with others, remembering the need and acknowledging it and responding joyfully and with grateful hearts. Let us always remember what we can give to the work of our church, to Christ's work in the world in so many ways. And let us pray. Lord, let our congregation be a witness to you, immersed in scripture, constant in prayer, joyful in worship, generous in giving, a loving, supportive community, reaching out to those in need. Accept the gifts we offer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
We come to God each week with prayer and supplication and with thanksgiving. This morning I'm going to lead you in moments of guided silent prayer. Even though each of us prays in our own hearts, our prayers are not solitary when we join together as the people of God, praying as one in many voices. Let's pray. God, creation is so much with us. Sights, sounds, tastes, fragrances. We pause now to give thanks for something in nature that gave us joy this week. You have brought people into our lives. We pause now to give thanks for an experience of joy we have had with others this week. We pause now to ask forgiveness for a time where we have disturbed or destroyed another person's joy. We pray for someone who is particularly on our hearts today, who we know is in need of joy. We pray for a place in the world that's on our hearts, that needs to know the joy that comes with peace and justice. God of grace, thank you for hearing our prayers and for answering them. Hear us now as we continue to pray the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We close our worship experience this morning singing together, Go Make a Difference, which is More Voices, number 209. Table, holding the precious ointment, her eyes meeting and holding the gaze of the one preparing to die. Mary fell to her knees and broke open her treasure, massaging the fragrant oil into his feet and wiping them with her hair. Mary kept her eyes on his as a collective sigh arose, followed by a bitter criticism, an attempt to disqualify her action. Mary's tense shoulders relaxed at his words. Leave her alone. Defended by Jesus, she could take on the whole world. Jesus, friend and defender, may we who remember her story be emboldened to live with sensuality, courage, passion, and great joy. To God be the glory. Amen.